And now let's knock on the door of the good Dr. Watson's library and see if he's expecting us. Don't say he's forgotten his appointment. That's odd. I think I'll look inside. There's the answer. He's asleep. Doctor. Dr. Watson, wake up.
Holmes. Holmes, look out for that bearded Hindu. He's right behind you. And I think he's got a knife.
Wake up, Doctor. It's only me.
Who's you? Foreman. I take a little nap.
And you were talking in your sleep, Doctor. Something about Sherlock Holmes and a bearded Hindu with a knife. Didn't you tell us last week that one of the characters in tonight's adventure was a bearded Hindu?
Yes, that's right, Mr. Foreman. I did, but settle yourself down and I'll tell you the whole story. It began on a summer evening in 1906. I'd been for a long walk in the park. I remember when I returned to Baker Street and entered our rooms, Holmes looked up at me with a twinkle and spoke.
You look positively glowing with health, Watson.
Well, I had a splendid walk, my dear fellow. You should have come with me. The park was looking particularly beautiful.
Well, old chap, during our absence, I've decided to write another monograph.
Oh, what's the subject this time?
Occupational liability to murder. For instance, the mortality rate is naturally high among policemen and detectives. Physicians are murdered with fair regularity, but the murder of a dentist is rare. And who ever heard of a murdered veterinary surgeon?
That's quite true, but what's the occasion for this little homily?
I've been browsing over my newspaper clippings.
Yes?
You recall ever hearing of a murdered tobacconist, Watson?
No, I can't say that I do.
No, why? And yet my clippings inform me that no less than 3 tobacconists have been murdered in the past 6 months, and all the murders have occurred in the same small shop at the East End of London. Now, why do you suppose 3 tobacconists would be murdered in the same shop? Come now, old fellow. Give me a logical solution to the problem, will you?
Well, let me see. You say that the shop's in the East End?
Yes.
Is it near the river?
As it happens, it's on the water's edge.
Then supposing the tobacconist's shop was the headquarters of a smuggling ring. Perhaps boxes of cigars were unloaded from the dock and brought to the shop. Cigars containing pearls or opium or something.
Watson, my dear fellow, you're doing splendidly. You must walk in the park more frequently. You're positively scintillating.
No, you're making fun of me.
I assure you I'm not.
You're expecting anyone home?
No, probably a visitor from Mrs. Hudson. Go on with your fascinating theory. Now, why are 3 tobacconists murdered?
Well, because they know too much. Perhaps they demand a share in the profits, so the head of the ring decides to kill them.
Plausible enough, Watson. I really must congratulate you. I can see that I'm very lucky in having a biographer with such a lively imagination.
Thanks very much.
Come in.
That's very nice. Imagination. Oh, hello, Lestrade.
Lestrade, I'm glad to see you.
I hope I'm not intruding.
Not at all, my dear fellow. Come along, sit down.
Thank you, Miss Holmes.
Anything remarkable on hand?
No, Miss Holmes. Nothing very particular.
Then tell me all about it, Lestrade.
Can't hide anything from you, can I, sir? Yes, there is something on my mind and no mistake.
And it concerns the 3 murdered tobacconists, I see. Splendid.
Now, how the blazes did you know that?
Yes, Holmes, that's pure magic.
Not at all, my dear Watson. It's simple deduction.
Exactly.
Observe the 5 cigars peering out of Lestrade's breast pocket. They are of a far superior quality to his usual brand. Obviously, the scene of his latest investigation has proffered certain, well, shall we say, professional perquisites. Am I right, Lestrade?
Of course you are. Care for one, Mr. Holmes?
Thank you, I'll stick to my pipe.
Well, how about you, Doctor?
Oh, thank you, Lestrade. By Jove. Coronas.
And now, Inspector, tell me about the murdered tobacconists.
Well, how much do you know about the case?
Oh, just what I've read in the papers.
Well, curiously enough, we were discussing the affair as you walked in, Lestrade.
It's a strange business, gentlemen. I only got hold of the old story today when I had a long talk to young Jack Longworth. He's the owner of the shop.
Oh, in relation to Gerald Longworth, the taller member of Parliament who battled so successfully against the slum clearance bill?
His son, Mr. Holmes.
What's
nice young fellow, too. When his father died, he inherited this shop along with a lot of other property in the East End.
Well, how big a shop is it, Lestrade?
Oh, just a hole in the wall, Doctor. Like all the other shops in that part of London. Young Mr. Longworth Jasmine first rents it to a man by the name of George Grillet. He lives there with his daughter Lily and made it quite a nice go out of the shop. 6 months ago, when Jack Longworth was abroad, George Grillet has a stroke and nearly kicks the bucket.
Kicks the what?
He nearly dies, Doctor.
Oh, kicks the bucket. Good. I remember that.
And then what happened, Lestrade?
Well, while he's in the hospital, his daughter gives up the lease on the shop. A few days later, an Italian takes it over, and a couple of weeks later, he's found with his throat cut.
Did you investigate that first murder yourself?
No, Mr. Holmes. It seemed like any of a dozen killings we get in that part of London. A shopkeeper cut up, his till emptied, no clues.
Well, who was the next tenant?
A Scotchman. Bloke by the name of McIntosh. A few weeks after he moved in, the same thing happened to him. That time, I did go down there, but I couldn't find out nothing.
Was robbery again the apparent motive?
Yes, sir. But the killing wasn't the same. He was strangled with a silk scarf.
Silk scarf, eh? And who was the third tenant, the man who was murdered yesterday?
A Hindu fella. A man by the name of Mukherjee. He takes it over a week last Friday, and yesterday we finds him knife through the back and his money gone. Of course, I was down there before you could say Crystal Palace. But once again, I didn't find out nothing. No knife, no fingerprints on the till, no footprints. Just a very dead Hindu.
Was young Mr. Longworth a landlord in England when these murders occurred?
Yeah, that's the funny thing about it, Mr. Holmes. He doctored Tilbury yesterday morning. He didn't know nothing about what had been going on.
Well, I imagine he'll have difficulty in renting the shop after three murders.
Well, that's just it, Doctor. That's why he comes to me at the yard. George Grillet, his first tenant of the shop, moved back there today with his daughter Lily. And young Mr. Longworth's worried about them. Well, if you ask me, he's more worried about the daughter than he is about old man Grillet.
So the original tenants of the shop are back in residence again, eh? And what do you want me to do?
Well, I thought perhaps you'd be interested enough to come along with me and look at the shop, Mr. Holmes.
I shall be very glad to, my dear fellow. Get your coat and hat, Watson.
Oh, that's your... Oh, dear, that wretched instrument.
I'll answer it. Hello? Mycroft, how are you? What? Yes. Yes, he's here now. Why, of course. I'll do everything I can, certainly. Let's have dinner together soon, shall we? Splendid idea. All right, goodbye.
Well, was that your brother, Holmes?
Yes. Lestrade, I do think you might have told me the whole truth.
Well, how do you mean, sir?
I thought your visit was prompted by a need for friendly assistance. I didn't realize that you came here virtually on a government order.
Well, it wasn't just quite like that, Mr. Holmes.
What's the government got to do with the case, and how does your brother Mycroft fit into the picture?
Not sure yet. But of one thing we may be certain, there's obviously a great deal more in this case than Lestrade would have us believe.
Why do you say that, Holmes?
You must bear in mind, old fellow, that occasionally Mycroft is the British government.
Yeah. Nice part of London to take a walk in on a foggy night, ain't it, gentlemen? All our policemen work down here in pairs, you know.
Yes, I don't blame them. It's a vile neighborhood.
There's the shop just ahead of us, with a sign hanging out. Hello, hello. There he is again.
Oh.
See that bearded Hindu skulking off around the corner there?
Oh, yeah.
He's been haunting the place ever since I came down here.
So a bearded Hindu haunts the place, eh?
Yes, and yesterday, Holmes, the Hindu proprietor of the shop was murdered.
Exactly.
Well, here we are. I'll go in first.
Depressing looking place, huh?
I'll be out in a jiffy.
That's Lily, George Grillet's daughter. Helps him with the shop.
Sorry to keep you wet. Oh, it's you, Inspector Lestrade.
Yes, Miss Lily. I brought some gentlemen to see your father. This is Mr. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson.
Pleased to meet you, I'm sure.
How do you do, Miss Grillet?
How do you do, young lady?
Is your dad home?
No, Inspector. He won't be in till after dinner. Went down at the docks, he did, to see about some cigar shipments. Mr. Longworth's here. If you want to see him, we were just having some tea in the back room.
Yes, I'd like these gentlemen to meet him.
Jack, come out in the shop, Jack.
What is it, Lily? Oh, Inspector Lestrade. And this must be Mr. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, I'm sure.
How do you do, sir?
How are you, Mr. Longworth?
I'm very glad the inspector was able to persuade you to come down here, Mr. Holmes.
I'm dreadfully worried about this business, particularly since Lily's father insisted on coming back here. I'm afraid they're in great danger, but I can't make Mr. Grillet see it.
Young lady, I wonder if I might ask you a few questions.
Hey, of course, Mr. Holmes.
Before your father had his stroke, did he receive any threats concerning his occupancy of the shop?
Well, if he did, he never told me about him. But it wouldn't surprise me. I often told him his biggest enemy is himself, if you know what I mean.
Yes, I think I do, Miss Grillet. When your father had his illness, who decided to give up the lease on the shop?
I did. No money was coming in, and, well, it looked like Dad might be an invalid for life.
Mm.
Of course, I couldn't run the shop by myself. Anyhow, I never did like this part of London. It wasn't the right business for Father.
What was his reaction when you told him to have given up the lease?
Oh, he was awful angry with me. Said I'd no right to do it without asking him.
By the way, we saw that bearded Indo again as we walked up just now.
He's been hanging around ever since we came back here, Inspector.
Well, has he actually come into the shop, Miss Grillet?
No, but he keeps walking by and looking in the window. I'm sure if we both went into the back room or left the shop for a little while, well, he'd come right in.
Then I suggest we give him the opportunity he's seeking. Miss Grillet, I wonder if you and Mr. Longworth would mind leaving the shop for a while.
Of course not, Mr. Holmes.
Make your departure rather ostentatious, shall we say, so that he can't help noticing it. Give us half an hour or so and then come back. Perhaps you wouldn't mind going with him, Lestrade.
But, Mr. Holmes, this is my case.
I know, but in a situation like this, Watson and I work much better alone. We may have to go a little outside the law, and your presence might embarrass us.
You'd never think I was a detective, too, would you?
Very well,
we'll be
Mr.
back
Holmes.
In half an hour.
Poor old Lestrade. He gets very touchy as the years roll by.
Yeah, I blame him. I'm leaving him completely in the dark. Come on, Watson, behind the counter. No, my dear fellow. Not under it, old chap. We lift the flap.
Oh, good.
So. Now I suggest we crouch down behind here. Come on. That's it. Have you got your revolver, Watson?
Yes, it's in my pocket.
Good. In the meantime, make yourself as comfortable as these cramped quarters will permit. We may have quite a wait ahead of us.
Put your hands up. I got you covered with this revolver. Now, my man, what are you doing here?
Who are you?
Never mind who I am. Just answer my question.
I do not speak very good English.
Tum Hindustani bat bolen, Sector?
Ah, Sector, hi.
Iko tum ida aya?
Dek me koasti, tumara bai, humko, hukam dia.
Tumara bai? Tum jani, Sector?
Bot acha. Salam.
No, you don't, my man. Just you stay where you are.
It's all right, Watson. Let him go. He's on our side.
I wish you'd tell me what in thunder's going on, who that man was, and why you let him go.
He's an investigator from the Foreign Office, old chap. Given his instructions by my brother, Mycroft.
Mycroft?
Yes, old fellow. When my brother fails to tell me all the facts concerning this case, I begin to think these triple murders have far greater ramifications than we ever dreamed of.
I don't see that you've accomplished much, Mr. Holmes, except that you've just bought me a nice dinner.
Oh, I'm making progress, Lestrade. If only by the elimination of obvious suspects. But there's a pattern to this case, and that should give us a clue.
Well, how do you mean, Holmes?
My dear fellow, consider the obvious motive of these murders, and particularly observe the results they've obtained.
Well, the motive was the same in all three killings. Robbery.
Oh, no, Lestrade. Don't let the theft of a few pounds from the till blind you to the real motive.
Look. Here's Miss Grillet now. Coming out of the shop.
Good evening, Miss Grillet.
Hello, Mr. Holmes.
Is your father home yet?
Yes, he is, Mr. Holmes. And I can't tell you how anxious I am for you to talk to him. I'm going to meet Mr. Longworth. He's taken me to the music hall. I should be home just after 10. I hope you'll be able to stay with Dad until then.
Well, don't you worry, Miss Grillet. We'll keep an eye on him.
Oh, thanks ever so much. Oh, Mr. Holmes.
Yes, Miss Grillet?
Please don't go into our rooms in the back, will you? I've left things in a frightful mess.
I quite understand, Miss Grillet.
Well, ta-ta all. See you later.
Let's go into the shop.
Who is it? Oh, it's you, Inspector.
Yeah, these gentlemen, Mr. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson.
Oh, how do you do, sir?
Good evening, sir. Good evening.
Did you meet young Lily just now?
Yes, she told us she was going out to the music hall with Mr. Longworth.
Yes. I'm afraid we had quite a set to about that. A very strong-willed girl, Lily, very strong-willed.
Am I to assume that you disapprove of your daughter's association with Mr. Longworth?
Yes, of course I do. He's a toff. He's got lots of money. Lily's so blunt she can't see that he's up to no good. I'm pretty sure he's afraid I might find out what's really at the back of these here murders.
And what is your theory, sir?
Well, I'll tell you this in confidence. Got nothing to back it up now, you understand. There's been talk of widening the docks around here. That'd make property values go up, you see, of course. Well, young Longworth's been trying to buy up all the other shops along the waterfront here, but they wouldn't sell. If you ask me, he's had these murders done just to frighten people away so that he could buy cheap. Now, I'm not saying that he did the murders himself, you understand, but he planned them. Why, in these parts, it's easy enough any night to get a throat cut for a couple of quid.
Yeah.
That's why I'm glad you're here, gents. You see, I just got another warning.
Warning? What do you mean, sir, warning?
Found this note slipped under that door there not 3/4 of an hour ago.
Let me see it, please.
Well.
What does it say, Holmes?
I shall call on you at 8:30 tonight. If you know what's good for you, you'll be waiting for me alone. If you try any funny tricks, you'll go where I sent the rest of them.
Well, that's obviously from the killer.
Possibly. What's the time now?
It's 8:20.
I was hoping you gentlemen would wait in our rooms back of the shop. You can hear what's going on in here, and if he tries any rough stuff, you can pop in and nab him.
Just what I was about to suggest myself, Mr. Grillet. Either way, will you?
Oh, yes. Just step behind the counter, gents. Through here. Here we are. Ain't exactly Buckingham Palace back here. But you can make yourselves comfortable, can't you, gents?
Oh, don't you worry about us, Grillet.
Oh, I better turn out the gas. If this bloke spots a light under the door in here, he might smell a rat. Now, there we are. Now, as soon as I see him coming in the shop, I'll knock twice on the door, like this. And that'll give you the signal that he's here. Is that right?
Right, you are, Grillet.
All right, now keep your ears open, gents. I may need your help.
Where are you, Holmes? I can't see a thing.
Over here, Watson.
You know, I've got another theory why Jack Longworth might be at the back of all this. You listening, Holmes?
Yes, I'm listening, old fellow. What is your theory?
Longworth knows that Grillet doesn't approve of his having anything to do with Lily. So when he goes abroad, he leaves instructions to murder the tobacconist. The assassins don't know about Grillet having a stroke, of course, so they keep murdering the wrong fellow.
Well, that makes very good sense, Doctor. What do you say, Mr. Holmes?
Holmes. Holmes. Where are you? Bless my soul, he's disappeared.
No, I haven't. I was just exploring.
Shh. That's the signal. Listen. There goes the front door. Somebody's come in. We'd better go in.
Right, Watson, listen.
Hey, stick your hands off me. Don't you do that.
We've got to get in there at once.
Open the door.
Well, it's locked.
Never mind that.
Get your shoulders into it. Come on. Come on. Help me. On here. Go. Come on. One more.
Poor devil. He's been slashed with a knife. Willett. Willett.
What? The killer got away. I ain't going
to... Now, Lestrade, conserve your energy. Your murderer lies there.
But that's Grillet.
Of course it is. Search his pockets, Watson. I think you'll find a bloodstained knife.
Let's have a look. Good Lord. He has a razor in his pocket. It's covered with blood. You mean to say that he slashed himself?
Let's slip the handcuffs on him, Lestrade, while he's still play-acting. He may be more difficult to handle when he realizes the game's up.
Take your hands off
quick,
me.
Come on, quick. Come on, yes.
Hey.
Come on.
Oh,
Very neat, Lestrade.
Yeah. Well... Now that I've knocked a wounded man out cold, perhaps you'll tell me what's going on, Mr. Holmes.
Yes, I'm completely in the dark, too.
Oh, it's very simple, really. Willett has just staged a fake attack on himself to fool us into believing that someone else is the murderer.
Yeah, but the threatening note he received...
Composed by himself for the occasion.
Yes, but we heard voices. We heard the shop door open.
We heard Grillet talking to himself. And as for the shop door, that's how he gave himself away.
Well, how do you mean, Mr. Holmes?
Whenever the shop door opens, there's a bell that jangles. You will notice, so.
Yeah, that's right, there is.
There's no bell jangle when we were in the back room. Grillet got us in there, locked the door on us unobtrusively, and staged his little drama.
Yes, but we heard the door creak open and close, Mr. Holmes.
The creak of this flap in the counter would sound exactly the same, my dear fellow. Now listen.
Yes, but why, Holmes? How did you spot that Grillet was a man?
It was obvious from the beginning that since nothing had changed about the shop except the ownership, that the attackers were directed against any tobacconist who was not Grillet himself. Of course, his daughter, Lily, obviously knew what was going on.
Well, I don't see how you figure that one out, Mr. Holmes.
Every remark that she made showed that although she loved her father, she knew his failings. In any case, she gave me the final clue.
Well, what clue was that?
In very pointedly asking me not to go into the back room of the shop. Of course, she meant the reverse of what she said. I followed her advice when you were explaining your theory to Lestrade.
Well, what did you find, Mr. Holmes?
Miss Grillet had obligingly left a secret door open, a door leading to a passageway that seemed to go down to the waterfront. We'll examine it more thoroughly in a minute.
Yes, but I still don't understand Grillet's motive, Holmes.
Neither do I, old chap. Though I suspect that from the interest of the Foreign Office in the case, this shop has been the headquarters of an espionage ring. I'm afraid the final answer to that question will have to be given by someone else.
Oh, who, Holmes?
By my elder brother, Mycroft. Humiliating, isn't it, Watson?